today. I feel like this is really a watershed time for cats and sheltering in a situation that I've been engaged with, I feel like, since I was born. Certainly for my entire adult life. And some new ways of thinking about cats that are just so different and so exciting. And I don't know, Dr. Delaney, do you want to hold up your bars?
I have it, yes. There was like, I think a Tuesday in August when I got sick of euthanizing cats and I had some extra time, so we started doing our TNR program without any funding just because I felt like it. So this is our cats only for the whole year, so it's by month. Green is live release and red is euthanasia. And this is right around when I decided to stop killing cats. And then you can see that our green is just skyrocketed and the red is really minimal. And honestly, the red, nowadays it's almost always cats that if you came to me as an owner, I would tell you to euthanize your cat. Like I would say, your cat is suffering, we need to euthanize it. So we are really getting all the cats who should have a chance at life out of the shelter alive right now. And really without much funding so far. We're hoping to get funding, but you can definitely make a difference even without a lot of funds if you just kind of get some partners in the community or work a little bit harder or surge keep faster.
So we recognize that this is not a group of people who come from communities where you're just rolling in extra cash, and I hope that amongst these groups we can really brainstorm ways to get this done regardless of the community you're in, regardless of the resources you have. I think there are new approaches and new answers available to every single community. And in a way, it's almost more exciting for me when we make it work in a community that doesn't have a whole lot going for it, because that's something we can take as a model for the whole rest of the country that's accessible to anybody. So this is a short history of my career. As I said, I think I learned to speak so that I could request a cat. And my earliest ambition, well, I had two. One was to drive a cement truck, and I'm not really sure what came of that. But my other ambition was to run a cat hotel. And I spent a lot of time as a 4- and 5-year-old drawing plans and, you know, for the automatic petting machines and the tuna dispensers that would be in each luxury room in my cat hotel. And what's scary about this picture is it wasn't Halloween or anything. Like, I'm not sure why I was dressed up as a cat, but there you have it. I was really into cats. And then, you know, I grew up and I still, I loved all animals. We moved a lot, so a cat was a pet that I actually grew up with and was really my best friend growing up. But I felt like I wanted to put that love into action for animals, and so, you know, I realized my whole hotel concept was not the most sensible. And so I took a job at the Santa Cruz SPCA. I worked in all phases of that, but most of the time as an animal control officer. I was an animal control officer for 6 years before I went to vet school. And it just happened a few years ago to run across this article of me, like, and I could not have been more enthusiastic about what I did. Fully intended to do it for the rest of my life, until I realized that eventually I'd get too old to outrun the Rottweilers that were chasing me. And carrying in front of a wolf hybrid, a cat with great pride, like massively stressing it out. To a shelter that at that time released about 1 out of 4 cats alive. So that cat had about a 25% chance of survival. And it was one of my jobs as an animal control officer. There was no holding period for feral cats at all in those days. So if I picked up a cat that I couldn't handle and vaccinate in cage, I would march her straight back to the euthanasia room and euthanize her immediately. And it was an open intake shelter. We took all cats. We encouraged people to bring all cats to us on, you know, at any time. Took a lot of pride in that. And I would counsel people to, you know, call me. If you've got cats, trap them, call me, I'll come get them. And I was very bought into the idea that this was the very best thing I could do for cats. I didn't like euthanizing them. I didn't like putting them in a small cage where I knew they only had about a 1 in 4 chance of getting out alive. I wouldn't have done it if I didn't believe absolutely that the cats would suffer if I didn't do that, that the population would grow out of control, that they would have an adverse impact on wildlife, that it wasn't fair to birds, that it would create a community risk, and that this was what we needed to do, that it was right. It was right for cats, it was right for people, it was right for animals. Even though it pained me. And I continued. I loved this work so much. I went to vet school, and then when I had the opportunity to be the first person in the world to get advanced training in shelter medicine, I said, yeah, sign me up. I will, you know, continue earning less than I did as a dog catcher for another 3 years so I can really hone in on this whole homeless pet situation. And, you know, so I took it a step further, and one of the things I studied was feline upper respiratory infection, which is a stress-associated disease for cats, as you probably all know. Some of you might have heard me speak about it. And in my research, I kept coming back to the fact that we cannot control this disease unless we can provide good conditions for cats. Not amazing conditions, but just sort of good-ish. Kind of larger cages than we're used to, and softer beds, and maybe a little toy or something to scratch on and a place to hide. And I had such a hard time finding ways for shelters to be able to provide those minimally good conditions to control this disease. And so I kind of came to this feeling like, wow, you know, I can research upper respiratory infection till my head falls off, but if shelters can't implement because they can't provide for the cats and their care, it's not meaningful for me to do this work. One of the things I saw is that very commonly, shelters would get so crowded with cats that even though if they had basically good housing, they'd get all crowded, and then the cats would get stressed, and then they'd get upper respiratory infection, and then the cats would get euthanized. Mm-hmm. And so one of the things I worked on was developing algorithms for shelters to decide which cats to euthanize so they wouldn't have to wait for upper respiratory infection and crowding to happen. But it's very hard to euthanize cats when they're still healthy. But the answer shouldn't be that we wait till they're not healthy and then we euthanize them. The answer should be that we don't euthanize healthy cats. And, you know, for a long time I thought, well, it's just not as simple as that. But in looking at, you know, emerging research and new programs, I've come to the conclusion that maybe it is a lot simpler than I thought it was. And a lot of the assumptions that I've really based my life's work on have been wrong. I feel bad about that. In all seriousness. But I'm here to apologize. And it's very exciting because the assumptions that I now think were wrong were the ones that made me most sad. And were the most painful to implement. And I think one of the reasons why is because they just felt wrong. Like, this can't be. This can't be the answer. This can't be what we're working for. So here's the thing about cats. Cats are not the same as the other species that we deal with. Which of these things is not like the others? Which of these things would you be concerned about if you saw it hanging around by the dumpster behind your gym? Right? If you saw this in the parking lot outside, you'd be pretty sure you'd be like, that is a problem. That cow is not where it should be. This is a species I like to call a bunny rabbit. And if you saw some of those hopping around in the alley behind your house, you would know, like, those bunny rabbits should not be there. I should take them to an animal shelter, and we should find them homes. Right? This. What about this? That could be a kitty cat that needs a home and a fireplace and a couch and a lap. Or not. Which of these things is not like the others? Which of these things, if you saw it in a field, in an alley, hopping around, rooting through a trash can, would you say, I should capture that. I should bring it into an animal shelter. I should hold it in a cage for 4 to 6 days. If I can't find it a home, I should give it a lethal injection, and I should dispose of its bodies at the taxpayer's or donor's expense. And that would be a logical thing to do. This is the same species as a bunny rabbit. This is a naughty jackrabbit. They could breed. But we recognize that it would be ludicrous to approach jackrabbit populations. The nuisances they cause, the concerns they cause, the risks that they suffer, being naughty jackrabbits out and about, hopping around in the world. We realize it would be absurd to think we could chase them down, drive them around in trucks, bring them into animal shelters, put them in cages, vaccinate them, hold them, try to find them homes, spay and neuter them and try to find them barn or field homes, and then kill them if we can't figure out anything else to do. We recognize that it's citizens' responsibility to live with these creatures. We don't go and trap them and contain them and kill them if people can't figure out how to put a lid on their garbage can. Right? We find other methods of responding to those species. But it's confusing because this looks just like a kitty cat. And so there's pressure to respond to it as if it's a kitty cat. And to respond this whole free-roaming, freely breeding population with the same tools that are successful tools for responding to Labradors that are running loose or cows that have gotten out of their pasture. So this is what makes cats so different than the other species we deal with. They exist on a continuum. This is a cat palace that I visited in Virginia, owned by a multimillionaire, who has just furnished this whole residence for her cats. There's 20 cats and their staff that live there. And antique furniture and paintings and dishware, all of it cat-themed. It's a little bit freaky. All the furniture has claw feet, and like I was there alone one night, just with me and the cats and all the eyes from all the paintings. So those are cats. And then there's cats that are unowned but are friendly, right? And cats move fluidly between their situations. You know, the palace gets foreclosed, all of a sudden, they're unowned but friendly cats. Then they have some babies, and they become unowned, unhandleable cats. And cats can move between those states of existence, right? But from the cat's point of view, how it should be managed, it's not really determined by whether we can pet it or not. It's really determined by whether it's doing okay in whatever situation it finds itself in. And the thing that makes this challenging is that not only is there an enormous population of owned cats that we're trying to get a handle on, but there's also about an equal population of unowned cats. And the great majority of owned cats are sterilized. And it was interesting to me to notice that actually in every study that's been done, more cats are sterilized than dogs. So even though we feel like we're struggling more with dogs, it's not because we're not getting the sterilization message to owners of cats. We're not getting the message to the unowned cats to bring themselves in. So I'm using the term community cats to mean any unowned cat, regardless of its temperament, because what we need to think about is not could we put this cat in a home, but how's this cat doing in the community? These are some of the assumptions that we've made in sheltering for 140 years that don't apply super well to cats. So spay, neuter, and educational efforts targeted at owners and pets will reduce shelter intake. That is true. It will reduce the intake of owned pets. Those will reach owned pets. Animals admitted to the shelter have owners who might come looking for them. So we'll talk a little bit more about the agonies that we go through to try and hold naughty jackrabbits for their owners to come looking for them. Right? When we're holding cats, one of the reasons why people don't reclaim cats is because a lot of those cats that we hold do not have an owner. That's an invalid assumption. that we're even making. And it means that stray holding periods for cats just don't make sense. They don't serve cats well if we're including a whole unowned cat population in that group that we're holding. And we sort of assume that animals admitted to the shelter could be adopted if not reclaimed. That's one of our assumptions when people bring cats to the shelter. The thought is, well, at least it'll have a chance. But we know that some cats coming into the shelter have no chance if adoption is the only live outcome that we can provide for them. The extent to which this applies to cats will vary by the size of the unowned cat population in a community and how many unowned cats are coming into a given shelter. But to the extent that we're using tools designed for an owned pet population and responding to an unowned pet population, we're going to drive ourselves crazy. We're not going to succeed. And that's what we've been doing in shelter for a long time. So, how many of you feel like things are getting better for dogs more so than they are for cats at your shelters? It's pretty much. Anyone find that dogs are struggling more than cats? And that's certainly been nationwide and California-wide. You're not alone. So in 10 years, cat intake in California went up by 28% per 1,000 capita. So that's not just as a function of the population growing, but even more cats per person in California are coming into shelters, as well as almost 75,000 absolutely more cats coming into shelters. Dog intake in the same time period went down a little bit per 1,000 capita, and euthanasia went down by over 60,000. I know this is a hard slide to look at, Dr. Delaney's picture.
Sac County, I used to be the vet there.
Oh, yep. And I know that most of you in this room have seen this site.
I've done that site.
Have done that as I have, believing that it was the most right thing we could possibly do, right? Yeah. Every day in California, 756 cats. In 2000 to 2010, 2,510,741. This is a huge investment we're making. Perhaps the single greatest investment we're making in cat welfare, in protection of birds, in community health with regard to cats. What is the financial cost of 756 cats a day multiplied by all the days in the year? What is the human cost for you, for me, the 24-year-old that loved cats so much that I wanted to run a cat hotel, and that was my job? And what is the opportunity cost? What are we not doing because we're doing this? What programs are we not inventing because this takes up all morning in the summertime? What more effective, more humane, more creative responses are we not discovering because this has been the way out that community members have expected of us for 140 years in the United States? Do we do this because we don't love cats? Raise your hand if you don't love cats. Why do we do this? We have really important goals that we're trying to meet with a sheltering program. And I'm going to go through them one by one. Do you see any of your goals that aren't here? If you're with an animal control program, first and foremost, you have to abide by the law of our state, right? You have to do that. You have to resolve citizen complaints and concerns. You have some obligation for that, or you're going to get no peace in your life. You do want to reunite lost pets with their owners. That's a big goal of a sheltering program. You want to provide adequate care to maintain the health and welfare of the animals in your shelter, whatever their outcome. And it feels so much better when we can do that. You want to find new homes for cats. You want to euthanize only those cats or those animals that are suffering or dangerous. And you want to reduce the suffering and harm associated with homeless and abandoned animals, but especially in this context, cats, in your community, for the cats themselves, for pet cats, for wild animals, for people. And then ultimately, why are we here? To solve the problem of feline overpopulation overall, right? Did I miss anything? I'm going to go through this point by point and talk about how we are or are not succeeding with respect to cats. It's not a law. We don't have to do this. This was a stunning realization to me. I was looking at the code, and I was like, does that just say dog? And I emailed a lawyer that I know, and I said, does this just say dog? Like, where's the cat section? Where's the section that says we gotta pick up cats? And she's like, there isn't one. Boom. We do have an obligation under cruelty laws to respond to animals that are suffering. Under rabies control laws, to respond to animals that pose a public health threat. We know that is a much smaller and more manageable subset of cats. Tomorrow, you could decline to intake any cat you feel wouldn't be best served by admitting it to the shelter. Holy cow. You do need to resolve citizen complaints and concerns if you're an animal control organization. And even if you're not animal control, if the activities that you're engaged in resolving these problems in your community are generating a lot of stress and complaints, there's going to be problems. You know, lawsuits will be filed, hassles will occur. But the truth is, when people really know that the choice would be between killing an animal and leaving it where it is, most people, over 3 out of 4, in fact, 4 out of 5 people would say, well, just leave it alone. So there are almost 20% of people who would say, no, I would like it killed. But there are people who want wild animals exterminated rather than trying to manage it in their environment. And we don't feel a need to have taxpayer-funded or donor-funded activities to provide that service. So yes, people will scream and yell if this service is discontinued, but not as much as you might think in some communities we're finding. And in fact, in some communities where alternatives have been offered, that 80% of people who doesn't want to see cats killed have said, wow, if I'd known there was another alternative that wouldn't put the cat's life at risk, I would have done it a lot sooner. So we have to think about who do we want to serve when we're resolving people's complaints and concerns. Talked about reunite cats. Not very successful compared to dogs, because a lot of them don't have owners. But the other thing is that people who do own cats, they're different people than dogs. They have different expectations for their cats, and they have different search and find behaviors. So this was another fact that when I read it, I had that feeling like, boom, we should not be taking in cats in the way that we are. People are 13 times more likely to be reunited with their cat through a non-shelter means than through a shelter means. People just like, when their cat doesn't come home, they don't immediately think, oh no, cat's not here, should go to the shelter before the stray holding period runs out. No, they wait and they're like, hey, did I see the cat today? Honey, did you see the cat? Maybe it's been a few days. Does anyone say, maybe we should look in the shed or something? By the time they figure out that the cat is missing, it's too late. And if we try to hold every cat long enough for people to figure out that their cat was missing, then we can't possibly hold that many cats and provide circumstances which will keep them healthy. So by impounding cats to shelters, we are reducing their chances of getting reunited with their owners. People's pet cats are being brought into shelters and being euthanized when they wanted them back. But they either didn't know to come to the shelter, they came too late, they didn't have transportation, they live in a community where they don't even know that if their cat disappears, they ought to go to the shelter. And it's surprising to me, but I've had this conversation with my own friends, and I've been harassing them for 20 years nonstop. And they're like, hey, my cat's been gone for a few days. Could you check down at the shelter? I'm like, what? What are you thinking? But if my friends do that, then you know that people, you know, they don't even speak English necessarily, but they love their cat, and they do want it back. And if it just was where it was, maybe it would just go back, or they could find it. We hold about 49 cats for every one that's reclaimed. So just on a financial basis, this makes no sense. This is with very conservative estimates of $2 a day for cost of care, $5 to bring it in, $5 to get it out the door, whether that's euthanasia or adoption or reclaim, and a 5-day stray holding period. And that's just, you know, get it in, hold it for us 3 days, and get it out. It's $1,000 per reclaim that we're investing to reunite one cat with its owner that would have been 13 times more likely to be reunited with its owner if we hadn't brought it in. By contrast, we only have to hold, this is on statewide data, 4.26 dogs for every one that's reclaimed. So it's only $100 for every dog reclaimed. It's a much more reasonable investment that we can potentially recover in reclaim fees, in adoption fees, in licensing fees. So this is just ammunition when you're talking about with your funders to say, hey, this doesn't make financial sense. And this slide is actually almost harder for me to look at than the morning's worth of euthanasia of cats. This is the sight that haunts me. This is the sight that drives me. It's just the conditions for cats so different from my cat hotel. And especially in the back rooms of shelters, in the holding areas, even if you've got nice housing in your adoption area, usually the cages are too small to even have good separation between the litter box and the food and water. And there's kitty litter in the cat's beverage, and they hate that. And it's not quiet. There's banging doors, there's barking dogs. The conditions are such that if they stay long enough, they'll probably get upper respiratory infection. An upper respiratory infection is not just a little kitty cold. It eats away at the passages of their nose. When we look at it, it's ulcerated, it's bleeding in there, it's painful. And for some cats, this is the last experience that they know. And again, what is the human cost of caring for a beloved animal in this way, bringing people who love cats into shelters and saying, this is what you'll do. This is the care you'll provide. And I've had prison inmates who are working in shelters turn to me and say, this shit ain't right. And they know that, you know, and they can kind of express that in a raw way that we all feel. Just to go back to that, we could provide adequate care for a number of cats. For a lot of shelters, it would be for about half as many cats as they're currently taking in. We could put holes in the cages, and that's all they need. So if we could have half as many cages with holes in them, then we'd be able to provide decent care. We'd be able to put the litter box on one side and food and water on the other side. We'd be able to put a little scratching pad in there. You know, if we had twice as much money for every cat, we'd afford $1.80 for a little cardboard scratch thing, a couple of toys. We had twice as much time. We could take twice as much time to close the cage door softly because we had half as many cats we were running around caring for. So it's not like we need the whole cat palace. We just either need a little bit more or a little bit less in the way of cats coming upon us at any one time. We are doing better with finding new homes for cats. How many of you have seen an increase in cat adoptions over the last 5 years? Not everybody, but, you know, we're getting off-site adoptions going, you know, in a lot of shelters and good promotions and understanding that we don't need to charge so much for cats and it doesn't make sense and we need to be more open about our adoptions, and we're succeeding In California overall, you can see that the trend over the last 10 years has been an increase from about 60,000 cat adoptions to over 80,000 cat adoptions. Woohoo! What's the bad news?
Yeah.
We took in so many more cats that we ended up with still 75,000 more cats euthanized. Here's part of the reason and part of the good news. We are not the only game in town. Like, this just in, people get cats from other locations than shelters. And different studies vary on how often that occurs. Like, in some parts of the country, people are more than twice as likely to adopt a cat as a stray than they are to go to their local shelter. But in every study, they're more likely to adopt as a stray than they are to adopt from a shelter. So when we do better on adoptions, and then people don't adopt strays, guess what? If there's unlimited intake, the strays just come to us, and we defeat our own purpose. But here's another thing to think about. The chances for adoption are not zero for a cat that's out and about. 34% of people get their cats as a stray. 41% are inflicted upon them by a friend or relative. We don't give the friends and relatives the opportunity to bring the cat to us. They can do a pretty good, darn good job of inflicting it on someone else. And in many cases, people who adopt stray animals are actually, as studies show, they're likely to have them spayed and neutered. So they'll do the work for us, and we can make it easier for them by providing them with resources, by providing them with opportunities to do that. We don't have to do it all, and especially when we can't do it all, and trying to do it all is compromising all our other activities, we're not serving the cats well. We can relax and just let some things that are out of our control anyway happen. Anyway, a little bit more than they already do. And this was a program, I got this data from a shelter in Buffalo, New York, that decided they were going to not take in stray cats if they didn't have room. So they were just sick of their shelter getting all overcrowded, and then all the cats would get sick, and then they'd have to euthanize cats. And they're like, no, we don't have to take in stray cats. If you call us, you've got a stray cat, you can hang on to it until we've got room. And they built up to 700 cats on their waiting list. And they're like, oh my God, we are never going to be able to, like, we're just going to have to move from Buffalo to Chico and change our address. But in fact, over 400 of the cats never came in. And they were able, over the winter months, to take in the remaining 300-some cats. And these were the outcomes. It was really striking. So this graph on this side is the outcomes for cats in California from 2000 to 2010. So that's a nice big data set of almost 4 million cats. And this red piece of pie is euthanasia. For sure, we know that is not a good outcome for the cat. And then the green slices of pie are the good outcomes, the live release. So 22% adopted, 2% reclaimed, and 5% transferred to other organizations. This is just from animal control shelters in California. Here is just this tiny red slice of pie. That was cats that were hit by a car that were on the waiting list. Less than 1%. These are pinkish slices of pie because they might be bad. This is vanished, about 10%. Maybe that was bad. Maybe they just went home to their owner. 23% of the people they couldn't reach, so they don't know what happened. 45% rehomed the cat. They did a pretty darn good job of inflicting it on their friends and neighbors. A better job than California animal control shelters in terms of a percentage. 14% we like to call suckers. They just accepted the inevitable. And we can help with that. If we're not spending so much on impounding and euthanizing cats, maybe we can help by offering them, like, you keep it. Hey, we'll give you a great deal on a little thing we like to call spay-neuter surgery. They have the same reclaim by owner rate as the California shelters, actually a little bit higher, 2.15%, and the same transfer rate. They took it, they inflicted it on another shelter, just as 5% of the California animal control shelters inflicted it on a rescue group. So again, we're not the only game in town. If we have more on our plates than we can handle, we can just say, you know what? Let's have the rest of it wait. You handle it out in the community, and here's one chance to find a good outcome, and then we can still give the cat another chance to find a good outcome if it's not possible out in the community. Then we can bring it into the shelter. Then that shelter was able to find good outcomes for every healthy cat that came in. This was a big concern for me as an animal control officer, and just like in terms of how I understood the word shelter, was to give a haven, a safe place for animals that might be at risk. And I was, I was roaming around in my truck and hearing people make threats against cats and seeing the bad things that happen to cats and picking up cats that were hit by cars. And I wanted to prevent that and keep cats safe. And I would tell people, you should trap feral cats because they don't have anyone to take care of them. And one of the things I didn't quite make the connection with, though, was the robust good health of most of the cats that I picked up and euthanized. And, like, they might not have had me and my cat hotel, but somehow they had it worked out. In the same way that somehow naughty jackrabbits and annoying raccoons and problematic skunks have it worked out. And this has been borne out by now hundreds of thousands of cats that have gone through TNR clinics. So in a study of TNR clinics, even in cold parts of the country like Minnesota, less than 1% of over 100,000 cats had to be euthanized because they were in such poor condition. And their body condition score was 4 to 5 out of 9, which is really between lean and ideal and better than the plump body condition, for instance, of my own pet cats. And we did a study where we looked at body condition score at a local open intake shelter that was just pretty typical city shelter, and their body condition score was 5, ideal, right there in the middle. Less than 10% of cats entering shelters nationally are sick and injured. It might vary in your community, but still, there's a good chunk of cats that are coming in the door and their own bodies are telling us, you know what, I kind of had it worked out where I was. So don't do me too many favors. In studies, the annual survival of cats that were being, had some care, like someone was sort of feeding them, was 90%. So that's pretty good. That reflects well, you know, sort of on what our common definition of a no-kill shelter is. 90% annual survival. And for kittens, it's lower in that, you know, it suggests that kittens, if we can trap and bring something into a shelter, kittens would be a good idea to bring in, to prioritize. They're also easier to adopt out. But still, even at a 75% mortality rate, that is not different from other wild carnivores. And I happened to be at a conference where someone was talking about lions, and a lion cub only has a 1 in 8 chance of growing up. I know, it's very sad. We certainly don't think it would be appropriate to race out and try and kill all the lion cubs in case, you know, just to prevent that ultimate untimely death. Right? We recognize that there's no other species for whom we think prophylactically catching them and euthanizing them to prevent something bad from happening later, if it's not happening now, would be a service to that living being. And the message, again, from the public is clear. More than 70% of Americans think shelters should kill only animals too sick or aggressive for adoption. And that's a real issue with dogs. You know, there is a real sticky problem of some dogs that we just don't feel are safe to place. We can't just trap and neuter them and put them back behind the gym. But not very many cats really are a significant danger to society. And so that is huge good news for us, because then there's no reason why, starting next week, all of a sudden, we couldn't have more options for cats and be able to do better for cats than we're doing for dogs in shelters right now. And I just wanted to say, you know, when I talk about the death of animals in shelters, I usually use the word euthanasia out of respect for the intentions of the people who are actually doing that work. But I think it's important for us to acknowledge what it really means for a feral or fearful cat. And if you haven't done this, and there's any question in your mind about whether we can provide euthanasia, for a feral or fearful cat to go into a cat room at the shelter where you work and stand in front of the cage of a feral or fearful cat for a minute and just experience what they experience. What smells, what sounds, what physical environment, how is that different from the physical environment that they came from? I know as an animal control officer, I watched feral cats run away from me on four broken legs because they would rather endure that pain than endure the terror of human contact. And that was in the days when there was no holding period on feral cats. And if we had a euthanasia drug that induced a 5-day phase of terror, what would we think of that? Humane euthanasia is off the table for feral and fearful cats. We cannot offer that. It's a false thing to offer, to be able to tell people, well, at least you can bring it in here and we'll provide it with a humane death. If there's a holding period and it's feral or fearful, we can't. We don't have that in our arsenal. We're killing cats. And those who have done it know it. I'm almost done with the depressing part. This is a big part of the debate in some communities, and it was certainly part of the obligation that I felt as an animal control officer. I was there to protect all species. And there can be no doubt that in some circumstances, cats kill birds and other native species. There is clearly some cases on islands and isolated habitat where cats have had a devastating effect on native species. There's also clear cases where cats have benefited native species by preying upon rodents that otherwise would cause even more harm to the native species. There are certainly some cases where the birds killed by cats would otherwise be killed by other cats or would fly into a window or something else would happen. And really, the impact of cats is trivial to non-existent. What we know for sure is that this is very microhabitat specific. It depends on the location, the sensitive species of birds that are there, the time of year, and the cats themselves. And what we also know for sure is that intake into shelters is utterly untargeted. It's not like a group of scientists are carefully sitting down and saying, if we're going to do this terrible thing to cats and to ourselves, let's be really sure that it's going to help. And we're picking the right cats at the right time to protect the right habitats. And that removing the cats is the best thing that we can do. We can't do other things to protect the habitats or spay and neuter and return the cats. There's nothing else we can do. That's not what happens. Somebody wakes up in the morning, wants to do something about a cat because they're worried about it or because they're annoyed by it, and they bring it into the shelter. Right? It's not strategic. It's difficult to find anybody to even comment on how we would develop such a strategy because we've been so reliant on just this untargeted, citizen-driven, sort of annoyance-driven activity. And the bottom line is, it is too small in scope and it is too untargeted to make any difference. We are not on an island in our communities, and we don't have the opportunity to completely eliminate the cat population. Even on places like New Zealand, where there really is, you know, huge risk to native species, and they're willing to use lethal means, which are much cheaper and faster than bringing cats into shelters, still, it's a struggle. We don't have the will to just go out and kill all the cats. Thank God. You know, we're not going to shoot them. We're not going to poison them. And bringing them into shelters is just too inefficient to eliminate them. So while there may be times when the cats cause harm to wildlife, discontinuing something that's ineffective is not going to make that worse. Meanwhile, maybe it opens up our minds, our energy, our time, and our recognition of the need to protect wildlife to do other things. And the percentage of cats kept indoors has gone up by 30% in the last, I'm not sure how long, but since the last time I was tested. That has taken tens of millions of cats off the streets, permanently, for their whole lives. That could have a huge impact. You know, if removing cats from the streets is what we want to do, how about doing that? You know, that's so much more humane for us and for the cats. And potentially cheaper, you know, chance changing someone's mind about where their cat spends its days and nights. This was a really interesting series of articles that was published in the Sacramento Bee about lethal predator control, where it was sort of a similar thing. That, and they figured out that killing coyotes just didn't help. It wasn't, you know, they just couldn't go out and kill all the coyotes of the earth, and so if there was any coyotes left, then they could still prey on livestock. And the ranchers, they wanted those coyotes dead. But in Marin County, they said, no, you know, we outlaw that. And that was about 10 years ago. And then the ranchers were forced to find other solutions. And guess what? The other solutions were way more effective at protecting wildlife. And I feel like we almost have a responsibility to force some different answers. Because by relying on something that's not working, not only are we hurting cats, but we're utterly failing to protect the wildlife that we aim to protect. And I'm not going to go into this because it's exactly the same rationale. Yeah, cats carry diseases. So do raccoons. If you garden without gloves on and you don't wash your hands and you put your finger in your nose or your mouth, you're going to be at risk of diseases. But killing all the cats that might poop in a garden versus teaching people to wear gloves or wash their hands, wash fruits and vegetables carefully, not eat raw and undercooked meat and milk. Much better way. Just more cost-effective and more sensible than thinking that we could just eliminate the cats from the world. And this is the bottom line. At the beginning, I talked about those 80 million-ish unowned cats. This is a small group. We're not rolling in dough. We don't have giant trucks to go out there and collect all the cats systematically. And if you do the math for your own community, never found a community that was getting more than about 5 to 10% of the outdoor cat population. We know from managing other wildlife species, we've got to remove, kill, permanently take out of the population 50% or sterilize 75% to have an impact on the overall feline population. So my frantic work as an animal control officer trying to solve the feline overpopulation problem, one cat, one trap at a time, it just wasn't enough. This graph shows, this red piece of the pie is the outdoor community cat population in California. Blue piece of the pie is the outdoor pet cat population in California with a conservative estimate of only 40% of people letting their cats out. This purple piece of the pie is cats impounded and euthanized. This green piece of the pie is cats impounded and released alive. And the invisible piece of the pie is cats in shelters rather than out and about in communities on any given day. So remember, we only needed to have about half as many cats in our shelters on any given day to be able to provide them with adequate care. If we had 0.00025% instead of 0.0005% in our shelters on any given day, it will not make one whit of difference. So we could just wait and take in cats when we have room for them. And we can euthanize cats that need to be euthanized and not euthanize cats that don't need to be euthanized and realize we will not impact wildlife. Community feline overpopulation. This is awesome news. Do you see it?
Absolutely.
This was the thing that I thought, uh-oh. I think I was wrong about this being useful activity. This is what really hit me. And I can do this now for your own communities. Traditional sheltering. It's not an effective tool to protect cats, to protect wild animals, to serve communities. And I kind of think of it like we've been trying to hammer a nail with a hair dryer. And we've been trying to dry our hair with a hammer. And it hurts. And it's not working. And we should stop. And now I get to the happy part of the talk. But before I move on to that, are there questions about why? And I don't tell you this to make you sad or make you feel bad, because I'm right there with you. I tell you this to energize you and free you from continuing to engage in things that don't work, so we can take those off the table and just put new things on the table and communicate that with our other stakeholders too. Yeah.
I guess my problem would be to try to convince the city council, and I know that being with the wildlife people, they're very, very adamant about not wanting to TNR. So that even though we say we could do this tomorrow, I think the city shelter is restricted in terms the city council is their employer.
So maybe Bob can comment on that. Okay. And I'm going to go through some of the other options. So the option isn't just drop the ball. There's a lot of interim options. But ultimately, I think if we take one, if we drop one ball, and that ball is the unrestricted intake and killing of healthy cats at any shelter, taxpayer-funded, donor-funded, if we just take that tool away, like, that's not an option, all of a sudden, TNR looks a lot better. Because the option of having it mysteriously disappear is gone. And that's a huge service, I think, to the wildlife advocacy community, to have them understand, like, stop thinking about that tool. That tool isn't here. Let's sit down and talk about what other tools, and I'm going to talk about what other tools can we provide. Bob, do you want to comment on just communicating with government bodies about this? Because I was surprised by the response that we got.
We're down in Sutter County. Yuba City is the largest community there. And our policy was everything comes into the shelter. You don't turn anything away previously. It was probably early spring, mid-spring, when we started a relationship with Dr. Hurley. And the first concept of, you know, you don't have to take cats came over the table. And everyone sort of thought, wait, really? We don't, huh? And then it kind of stayed right there, but it planted a little bit of a seed. And this was to the people who controlled money as well. So it had that small seed set out there. Then we got into cat season, kitten season, and suddenly we're inundated with cats everywhere. And when the shelter became full, and I didn't have room for any more, I just decided to tell people, I don't have room. Call me tomorrow. See if I have room, but I will not take your cat today. And suddenly that made a big stir in the media. Television stations, everybody says, wait, you have this new policy. And they came up to talk to us about this new policy. And I thought, great, you know, the litter's hit the fan here. You know, this is really going to come back and bite us. Because I thought the community would be outraged that we are not taking in cats voluntarily. I was surprised that after the little splash in the media, there wasn't a lot of buzz about that in the community. It stayed kind of low-key. And that was a little bit of a feeling of support and enthusiasm for us. For Dr. Hurley, it was, the door's open, I can walk in with statistics now. So that's when she did come in and say, as long as you're thinking about this, here's some facts. And she started dropping things that we've just heard right now on these people. And these movers and shakers started thinking, really? Really, that's how ineffective we've been? And the biggest thing that shook our community was to say, for the community cats that are out there, we would have to trap, spay, neuter, release 50 to 75% of those community cats in order to have an effective program. In our community, that meant 15,000 to 18,000 cats. We only see 2,500 or 3,000. Not all those are the community cats. So obviously, we're never going to be an effective program. Why are we spending the time and the money to do anything if it's doomed right from the beginning? Mm-hmm. That started growing. They started understanding that. And eventually, there was no argument from the people that were holding the money that said, we're wasting our money by continuing what we're doing now. And they were willing to take a risk and try something new. Our fear was, okay, now if we say we're going to stop taking any feral cat, which we did September 1st, we thought, now everybody's going to come to us. They're going to start saying, you know, oh, we've got 10 cats every day coming over our fence into everybody's yards. What are we going to do about that? Didn't happen. So all of these fears that we had, we geared up. We were ready with all kinds of answers, what to do when this army of cats came into your yard. We got all kinds of brochures from Alley Cats, and we were just ready to go. And yet, I can probably still count on these two hands the number of real complaints that we got over the last 3 months. So our fears were really unwarranted. It's a lot smoother if you've got someone on the front end who's going to say, here are the facts. And it worked.
Who is your they? City Council, Board of Supervisors, public donors?
We're in transition right now. It was originally just the Board of Supervisors for the county.
Okay.
We're now under a JPA, so it's joint. Not only do we have to deal with our Board of Supervisors, but the City Councils for the independent cities there
so
as well.
You're municipally managed. So that's who you have to convince.
We had to convince one, two, three, four different boards,
four
bodies, that this was the direction
to
go.
And we had this gal, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
So and
we don't have this.
It'll be on
this
right here.
At the time, I was done with them with my little rationale here. They were begging me to stop.
Yeah.
And they were like, we believe you. Please don't show any more slides. We're ready to vote. And I will come anywhere you request. I feel bad about this. I've been wrong.
This is your punishment.
First step is admitting you have a problem. My problem is, this is making me crazy now that I've done the math. Like, if this worked in any way, we would be having a whole heart-searching debate about this. But I can't find any reason not to do this. And so it will soothe my soul to come talk to your city council. We're recording this. Make them watch. Hi! Just do it and you can skip the second half. You know that thing about $1,000 per cat? That was compelling. You know, we're making it less likely that people who lost their cats are going to get them back. That was compelling. I see that I only have 5 more minutes. We're going to take a break.
So that we can keep recording.
Sorry.